Okay, we'll call the meeting to order. Roll call, Tracy.
John Bevan.
Here.
Kathy McGrath.
Here.
Kenny LeBrant.
Here.
And Tracy Lynch is here.
And Leo is an excused absence, so. All right, report from student representatives. No, consider approval agenda, I'm sorry. Gotta get in order here.
I so moved.
A second.
Been a motion and a second, any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the approval of the agenda, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Motion carried. Report from student representatives.
Okay, tonight we have a little bit of a different format. So we've got two groups tonight really presenting. One will come from our music department and represent our music department. The other report is going to come from our Skills USA student organization. And first up, we'll have our music department. And just a note on this, why we've switched this up. In 2 weeks, on the 25th of February, we're hosting the Central Wisconsin Conference Solo and Ensemble Music Festival. We expect several hundred students in the building that day performing both vocal and instrumental pieces, along with probably several hundred parents and all the instructors and bus drivers and people that go with making that event happen. So we're looking forward to that. And here today, representing the music department, Christopher Shields. So I'll let him introduce himself and what he's going to do.
All right, so I'm Christopher Shields, I'm a senior. I'm going to be playing a sax solo called Dorian Elegy. It's a slower song. I really enjoyed playing it this year. The solos I've had in the past have been kind of crazy and all over the place, and this one's a little bit more classical and slow. It's been a change of pace, but it's really fun to play. So, hope you guys enjoy it.
Thank you.
How many times have you been a solo ensemble?
This will be the seventh.
Because you started in junior high at that.
Yeah.
How many stars first have you already got?
Two times I've been a state for this.
It's like a third one coming.
Could you know what time you'll be performing?
No.
Not yet? Okay.
Schedule's still, it's almost done.
Almost done.
Yep. I get those last minute changes in there.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The second part of our student staff recognition and student presentations, as you will note in item number 3 under DPI proclamations, is Career and Technical Education Month in February, and we'll get to that in a moment. It's also, and because of that, there's also a proclamation regarding Skills USA, and we do have this group, student organization here at school, and they've come to as well talk about what they do. Mr. Bruno oversees that group, so I will turn it over to Mr. Bruno for a moment.
Okay. My name is Steve Bernal, and I'm the advisor for our Skills USA group. We've been a Skills USA charter here for, I believe, it's 3 years now. It started off with just a tech ed club, and it's transformed into a full-on organization. We've done different events from regional competition to state competition last year. This year, we're looking at doing the same. So I'm going to turn it over to my students here, and they're going to do a little bit of a presentation. So
I'm Cassidy Shasky, and this is my first year in Skills, but I am currently the Secretary of Skills. And it's been really fun. There's not very many members in it, but we've gotten a few more people to join, two more girls, so now we're up to 3. I was the first. But so far this year, we did the bonfire, we collected wood and we built it and stuff. And then we made ornaments and cards, and we took them to the elderly people at Edgewater. And we are now doing beef stick sales, where we sell all different kinds of beef stick. We've gotten like 3 or 4 boxes that have a whole bunch in them, and we've done really good with all of them. So
I'm Christopher. I'm also the Skills USA treasurer. We'll be making a budget for the club soon. What I mostly do as treasurer is handle, collect all the money from the beef stick sales so I can get it through to Mr. Vernon so it goes into the proper school channels. But what I really want to talk about is the regional competition that we were just at. We did a team engineering problem solving challenge. Myself, Austin Goodenough, and Jacob Warren all went. It was all our first time going to a skills competition. We were the only ones in the room, or it was the first time going. So that was a little different. Our challenge was to build a catapult out of popsicle sticks, Elmer's glue, rubber bands, and like this little plastic cup things that you find at Taco John's with salsa in. Yeah, we had to build catapults out of that. Our catapult, it was all right. None of us knew what we were doing, but it was fun. We ended up getting, I think, 11th out of 16, and our catapult exploded on the second time. But it was really fun to build. We learned a lot during that competition about skills and about the engineering problem solving, and we're gonna practice up and go to state. That.
How much time did you have to build that?
Two hours to build a half hour of the plant. So we did it in 2.5 hours. We were shooting marshmallows across the room.
So when you go in there, you
have no idea what they're going to have you do?
No. Last year, I think they built Bridges?
Yep, Bridges at regional, and then at state, they had to build a transportation system to transport paintball across a zip line into a piece of metal. They had to try to make the paintballs not explode. So that was very interesting, the different designs and the different concepts as far as the design aspect goes.
Where was Regional Hill?
It was at North Central Technical College near Wausau.
Now, as a state
Skills
USA competition,
how long has it been? Because, I mean, many years ago, when we were in high school, they had some
Challenge of the Minds or something. I'm just wondering if it's a spinoff of, is it Challenge of the Minds?
Odyssey of the Minds.
And this is a career and technical organization, so it goes hand in hand with the Technology Education Department. Really, Odyssey of the Mind was a gifted and talented program. So this one is...
Because it sounds very similar to the challenges.
Yeah, and maybe Mr. Bruno could explain. There's sure. different categories of competition. So their competition, yes, would probably be right along the road of that Odyssey of the Mind, but there's others that aren't. They're more... I'll let you explain. Okay. He'll do a better job at it.
There's over 155 different competitions at the state and national levels. So it could be anywhere from the technical skills to where it would be masonry, plumbing, whatever else it may be, culinary, beautician or cosmetology, or like they have the engineering aspect of it. So it ranges quite a bit. It's expanded over the last 40 years here. SkillsUSA used to be known as VICA. So if you guys have ever heard of VICA before, it has transformed names into SkillsUSA, so it's easier to be understood. So it's been around since the 60s, though. So it's definitely grown in size.
Great, glad we've got that group going.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. President's report, board member attendance. Leo is the only one that's not here. Reading of DPI proclamations. First one is from the Wisconsin Department of Public Instruction. Whereas the Association for Career and Technical Education has designated February 1st through the 28th, 2017 as Career and Technical Education Month. And whereas career and technical education increases graduation rates and improves academic performance through meaningful experiences, thus improving the quality of their education, engaging students, preparing them for careers in post-secondary education, and giving all students leadership opportunities in their fields and in their communities. And whereas career and technical education programs provide Americans with a school to careers connection, and are the backbone of a strong, well-educated workforce, which fosters productivity, innovation, and entrepreneurship in business and industry and contributes to America's leadership in the global marketplace. And whereas profound economic and technological changes in our society are rapidly reflected in the structure and nature of work, thereby placing new and additional responsibilities on our educational system. And whereas the ever-increasing cooperative efforts of career and technical educators with business and industry stimulate the growth and vitality of our local economy and that of the entire nation by preparing graduates for career fields forecast to experience the largest and fastest growth in the next decade. Therefore, be it resolved that I, Tony Evers, State Superintendent of Public Instruction, do hereby proclaim February 1st through the 28th, 2017 as Career and Technical Education Month. And the second proclamation is SkillsUSA. It reads, whereas the National SkillsUSA Association has designated February 5th through the 11th, 2017 as SkillsUSA Week, and whereas Career and Technical Education provides students with a school to careers connection and is the backbone of a strong, well-educated workforce, which fosters productivity in business and industry and contributes to our leadership in the national and international marketplace. And whereas career and technical education gives high school students experience in practical, meaningful applications of basic skills, such as reading, writing, and mathematics, thus improving the quality of their education, motivating at-risk students, and giving all students leadership opportunities in their fields and in their communities. And whereas career and technical education offers individuals lifelong opportunities to learn new skills, which provide them with career choices and potential life satisfaction. And whereas the ever-increasing cooperative efforts of career and technical educators, business and industry stimulate the growth and vitality of our economy and that of the entire nation by preparing graduates for career fields, forecast to experience the largest and fastest growth in the next decade. And whereas Skills USA, a state and national organization for students preparing for technical, skilled and service occupations in high schools, technical colleges and universities, helps its members become world-class workers and responsible Americans. Therefore, be it resolved that I, Tony Evers, State Superintendent of Public Instruction, do hereby proclaim February 5th through the 11th, 2017, as Skills USA Week. I know we've done a lot of those business partnerships in the last couple of years.
Yes.
So it's a growing field.
And we are now in, we have a student in the doors of Point Precision, Stevens Point, which is a very high-tech manufacturing facility. If anybody ever has a chance to tour it, it is notch. I think as we toured it, I think one of the comments made was it was not your grand, like you're not your grandfather's Oldsmobile or your dad's Oldsma. It's not your dad's metal shop. It's high-end, and we have a student working there. So the skills from Skills USA and our career and technical education, we've got students really now putting that to use. So,
if I may comment on that as a very telling proclamation, because they've got it nailed as far as what these kids coming out of high school need to consider in the trades and in that skills, because as an industry, the trades are going to be needing a lot of students coming in. The average workforce right now is in the middle 40s, and that's too high. Talking HVAC, plumbing, electrical, even carpentry as well, and that's going to start. So. And there's some very good opportunities to do well pay-wise and start your career a little quicker by going to some of the 1 and 2 year tech schools that are out there. So, or even getting on with an apprenticeship without necessarily going to a tech school, getting on to the with the right tradesperson and actually being enrolled in an apprenticeship type program. So a lot of opportunities out there for students. And just wanted to stress that spot on that proclamation.
All right, very good. And the next board meeting is March 8th. And then the next one after that is April 12th. So administrative reports.
So I wanted to just spend a moment, because I always get these questions, and I can be popular with the students 1 minute and unpopular with the parents the next over a snow day. So I thought I would just let the board know how we've worked things, let you know about the last couple that we've had and how our plans work. So in January, on the 17th and 18th, we were closed for inclement weather both days. And as you know, we had the ice storm go through on the night of the 16th into the 17th. And in making a decision to close school, really number one, student safety is first and foremost in our minds. I consult with the bus company and find out what their drivers and their folks are saying. We consult with the local superintendents. We have an interesting mix there, because we share bus service with Wisconsin Rapids in terms of the Lamers. However, Wisconsin Rapids also uses Safeway busing. So we use the same service through Lamers, but then they also use a second service with Safeway, as well as Nakusa uses Safeway. So we're not only getting information from Lamers, when I talk with the other superintendents, we're also looking at the information they're getting from Safeway as well. Third consult that we typically do, I'll consult directly with the Great Lakes Weather Service. That is a weather service out of Wausau. that is run by, it's actually run by Tony Schumacher. So if you watch one of the local TV stations, you probably see Tony. But sometimes I talk to Tony and sometimes I talk to Mike Brunling or somebody else. But we literally will talk with them and they will give us a little more insight into what's going to happen hour to hour from their point of view. It's interesting, about a month ago, I had a presentation from them at a superintendent's meeting. And of course, they said they're weather people, so they do get it wrong from time to time. So, but really, that particular ice event was kind of interesting. Primary concern from the bus company was back roads, country roads, because on the 17th, the municipalities were trying to get out and get things, but they were having a tough time getting out because it was that icy. So the main roads were their first concern, and as they tried to get to the secondary roads. And then on the night of the 17th, it again iced over, not quite as bad, but when we consulted with the bus companies, they were very concerned yet about the side roads, the back roads. They go out and drive those places. They get into the areas where they know they might have difficulty. So the bus company at that point, you know, said they were very concerned about the student safety. So at that point, again, we decided to close. We do not really have an effective, some schools do this 2-hour delay. We don't really have an effective system between the three districts that works out very well because of all the different start times that are going and whatnot. That really is what led up to that. Now, what does that mean for us? We do have in our calendar one day built into our calendar. The reason we have one day and not more than one, some districts have more than one. Several years ago, the district was able to receive a waiver from the state of Wisconsin on the school day total. So rather than 180 days, the school district was down to 175 student contact days. We also, now that requirement has lifted. We don't have a day requirement, but we do have an hours and minutes requirement. So we got to meet certain number of hours and minutes in a school year of instruction. One day is about all we can afford. We're that tight on our hours and minutes because we don't have the 180 days. So that second day is to be made up according to our calendar. The way that it's set up on the calendar, we're supposed to make up that day at the end of the school year. Now, as you may know, the end of the school year this year is on a Friday, which means we would have to make up the day on a Monday. One of the things that I would like, that I'm looking at, and I want to wait until March to bring this back to you, because February can be an interesting month. If we do not, by the board meeting in March, have more than one day, one of my options that I would like the board to look at is moving, we have an in-service day in May, is basically using that in-service day as the student contact day, so having the students report on that May in-service day, and then shifting the in-service day to the end of the school year, and having that Monday be an in-service day. Part of the reason, really the reason for that is productivity on a Monday of being the last day of school. The last day of school is not productive anyways. It's just something we want to look at. I'm not sure if we end up with another inclement weather day, it's really a moot point at that moment because we don't have really the extra days there left. So something we want to look at, but again, I want to wait on that at the moment. So the second part of my report is on social media development. Currently we have two social media sites that are external that anybody could look at. The elementary school has a Facebook page that they've recently started, and the high school, middle school has a Twitter page. And we do use both to some extent. We're not heavily followed on either. And things get on there when we're able to get them on there because just one of those manpower type issues, workforce type issues and where the resources are. So we do try to get things out there. One of the items that I looked at the state convention, the state education convention. It's the idea of how do we increase our exposure? Small district just north of us, Edgar. I want to say it was around 6,000 hits a day. Tracy was in that session with me, if she can put her mind to that. Was that about right? They're getting several thousand hits a day on their Facebook account alone, including some posts. They had one that was kind of problematic. It wasn't problematic in a bad way. It was kind of problematic in a good way. That had 180,000 hits. And they've had others that are in the tens of thousands of posts that they've put out there. So that's getting their good word out there to people. Wild Rose School District has recently done some changes. What was kind of unique in both of these cases, they've elected to go with a service to help them with their social media campaign and getting that positive word out there. Both Wild Rose and Edgar use a service, I believe it's called Social Media for Schools, and that particular service, what they do is they request from the school district that every staff member submit, I believe it's two items a month. You submit it to an email address, so the staff members would submit an item to the email address. They get vetted within the district, so there's a district person that vets those items. And then they actually leave that vetting process and go to this service. The service is actually resourced by stay-at-home moms and dads. And their entire job, once they get assigned to school, is to get school calendars out there, get the posts that the teachers are putting out there, get everything out there that they can, work with the district as well. They've done throwback, like the Throwback Thursdays on the Facebook. They've done staff things on, promoting staff members on Fridays where they highlight a staff member so the community and the public and the students can get to know the staff member. It was very interesting to see that done. I've talked with some of the, I've talked with that particular service and looked at that, and it's been a very positive. I've talked to Craig Hayes, who's superintendent at Wild Rose. They've so far only been on this about a month, but it's been a very positive. And not only do they develop the school district's Facebook, but they would develop the school district's Twitter and Instagram and whatever other social media outlets, right, with that. To get that message out there and do it in a positive way. That's just something I'm looking at the moment. There are some other services out there that will do that as well. There's some things internally we could start to look to do to at least increase our exposure. One of the recommendations that I've heard is bringing everything down into one set of accounts district-wide so that rather than an elementary page and a high school page and a Twitter account that's only high school, everything gets consolidated into one. So then it's, because otherwise people are going to multiple places. And the other piece of that is you can get all that information. Sometimes people, although they might have children at the elementary, might want to know what's going on at the high school and vice versa. It's very, very interesting to look at that. The other piece that goes with that is, starting to look at our messaging, not so much in what we're putting out on our Twitter account or what we're putting out on our Facebook, how we're doing that, and maybe how we're doing that district-wide in other ways. I think it goes hand-in-hand with the social media. This would be the idea of our branding. What's our branding going to be? What are we putting on our letterhead? What are we putting on our posters? What are we putting where? There's different ways to look at this, and this is something that I would like to start thinking about. I've gone back, Lisa, I've talked to Lisa about this. I consider Lisa the keeper of all knowledge. Because
she's been here forever.
Oh, I didn't say that. I just said she's the keeper of all knowledge.
Well, I know she's been here because I had her in third grade.
So one thing we've recently had some discussions about, so if you've been in the gymnasium, then we've got the Blackhawk on the floor and the Blackhawk up on the banners and whatnot. there's no designation of an official logo anywhere. There's no policy on it. There's nothing in any handbook on it. We've got in practice what we kind of have as an official, but I also know we've had, over the last five years or so, we've had some alternative, like helmet stickers out there and some alternative things put on t-shirts. There's positives, negatives about that. District up the road, in Nakusa, they've got their paper maker holding the roll of paper, but they also have like an N that's really stylistic that they use in their logoing. You know, for the most part, all of our official district publications are using the Blackhawk you would see in the gymnasium. We don't, although we did have floating around some old letterhead that was a different logo, which is actually on our cupola, right, outside. We actually have a different logo on our cupola than what's our current logo. So, you know, there's some things when we look at, if we want to look at a really positive social media campaign to start to think about, and then as well, how we're going to do our messaging. What I would like to do is, in over the course of this month, develop this even further, bring this back to you again regarding the social media side of it and our branding, and get moving down the path of how do we get our message out there. So
both Edgar and Wild Rose, they both, their Facebook pages,
they use social media for schools. Wild Rose just went on. Edgar's been on for a little over a year, I want to say. Wild Rose, it's kind of interesting. We were actually looking at a different service several months ago. And I just know that because we were using the same sales rep. But that service was, it wasn't going to provide us really as much hands-on help with it.
I'm going to comment because I'm not a Facebook user, yeah. And we're struggling with the same type of thing with our business,
yep.
Deciding what and how. And we are going to have somebody outside of our, yep, company actually do it. Then how do those personal, you know, I mean, would somebody snapshot something that you want post from here? I mean, some,
yep,
of that would still.
Yep. From my understanding, so the people that they have employed to the social media for schools, they literally, if they're assigned to your school, they're checking on you every day. They're checking on you in the morning, in the evening, middle of the day. They're checking on things going on. You do have some ability to get things on there directly if you wanted to post a score or something, because you might have to wait for your helper to do that. But what they're able to do is get it consistently out there for you versus
maybe it isn't.
If we give it to, and I'm just going to give you an example, if I give it to Miss Neve in counseling, but something happens where
she's doing something,
it may never get there then,
yeah.
You know. And so what they've been able to do, though, is, you know, and I'll give you this example. We have about 146 followers on our Twitter account. It's not very many. It just isn't. And we've had this Twitter account for a couple of years. I think Edgar has got almost 1,000 followers to their site. And again, they're getting I want to say it's around 6,000 hits pretty much on a daily basis on what they're posting. So, you know, because if I'm on Facebook and I might not be a follower of Edgar, but if I'm a follower of Mr. Dobbin and he's seen something and he puts it out there, then I open up what he's looked at. That's how that's happening. So it's just kind of interesting, a different way of looking at it.
I also went to two sectionals, one Jefferson, and I went to that one because one of our former students is a teacher there, Jesse, yep, Napgezek. And I'm not sure if it was, I don't know which company they used, but went to that one, and then also Durand, Wisconsin, and both of those districts have someone doing their, yep, social media, and they too said what a difference it made in the number of hits, you know. But they, yep, too talked also about branding, and just happened to be in the bank today down at Port Edwards, and I saw these buttons laying up on the counter, and I said to the gal back there, I said, oh, are these for sale? And she said, oh no, just take one. And I'm looking at it, and I said, that's not our walk. I didn't think it was. But anyway, she, yeah, so And I said, well, where did the, who's selling them? And she said, oh, a customer just, one of my client, or customers just brought them in and said, give them away. So I picked one up, but I thought.
Are they old? It looks like an old.
I think there's some, there could be like,
I don't know, old, like someone found them.
Maybe that was it, and they thought, just give them away.
But yeah, we've got a couple of different things floating out there, like I said, and I've literally seen the old letterhead on time to time resurrect itself. And we've been using the main letterhead with the Blackhawk on it for, since I've been here, probably before that. So I think that's something we want to wrap our minds around
right.
and think
and
about.
And I think it does need to be consistent. That's what they should
the
see
the
everywhere.
The only thing is that I think we need to maybe be cognizant of is the other ones are out there in the community, and do we want to wrap our heads around how much do you want to pull those back in, or do you want to say, you know, you could look at this in different levels, and you could say, all official district publications will be X.
Going forward.
Going forward. And you might say, you could say, that will be the only logo, that will be on anything we buy, anything we do, that will be it. There's another way to look at it, and some districts do, this is our main logo, it'll be on all publications and everything we do in that manner. However, there's an alternative here, and it can be used for this, this, and this, and just designating what it could be used for.
I think any one of those scenarios could be, as long as there's a policy that states it.
Yep, and right now we have nothing that really guides us in that direction. You know, and I looked at, you think about Coca-Cola. I most often think about it, when I think about it in the script form, but Coca-Cola is also just Coke, and it's the word Coke. So there are places that have several different brandings. The Wisconsin Badgers, oh my goodness. And I don't think we have to get that crazy by any means with if we were to do something like that. But there's a couple of different ways to look at it, and I think I want to do some more, I want to bring you some more information on what other districts, how they're approaching that, so that we can look at that. Because if we do something like a social media campaign and really improve that, I think we're going to have to also then think about what that branding is going to be.
Almost want to have the branding
kind of ready to go.
Decided before
right.
you, you know,
yep.
go out there.
And that's something too. The folks with the social media for schools said too. They are happy to, as well, assist in developing it with the school for the social media side and how that would work. So
I mean, what I learned from going to those sectionals is, if you employ someone to do this, you've got people that really know what they're doing.
Yep.
Plus, that's their job. Whereas if we assign it to a staff member or a support staff member, if they get to it, like you say, maybe it'll get done, but they're busy, and you just add something onto their plate, and that's not a guarantee that it's going to be done.
It's usually the bottom of the priority
right,
line.
Right. So I think we definitely need to look at that.
Last item on my report, student information systems. Our current provider is a company called PowerSchool. The school districts used PowerSchool for many years. That system used to be serviced through CISA 5, did direct support for PowerSchool. Several years ago, CISA 5 quit supporting PowerSchool, and it moved to a private support company. And we worked with that company. However, over the years, there are some things that have happened both in the world of student information systems, and in particular with PowerSchool, in particular with other companies out there. PowerSchool has been bought and sold a couple of times over the years. At different times, their focus has shifted. The companies that have owned them have not necessarily always focused directly on the PowerSchool computer program. At different times, they have. There are some interesting things like transcripts. Are not electronically provided through PowerSchool. We can add it, I believe, now with a specific cost, maybe add it. But we have more and more universities wanting everything to come across electronically. We've had some issues hosting locally. Some of our push notices, so those are the things like lunch menus, lunch balance accounts and things, have not gotten, at times it's been really a disaster, where things have not gone out that should have. And these are supposed to be automatic pushes and posts out the emails and those types of things. The other piece is Power School. Right now, and I'm going to go beyond Power School, we've got separated services, meaning we actually go through two different vendors right now for our curriculum services, so that help us map and track our curriculum. We go through a separate vendor for Instant Alert, which is that phone service. We've had a few issues there over the last year in the tech side of it. I think we've got that figured out for the most part. But we've had some functionality things. The other piece is PowerSchool is hosted locally, meaning we buy and put a server up in our tech room that runs PowerSchool. We are moving toward, we've worked with Sonata, worked with where we're at. We are moving toward a service, may or may not have heard of, many schools use it. It's probably prevalent in about half of the schools in the state, called Infinite Campus. Infinite Campus supports the curriculum side. They support the Instant Alert side. So whereas we're paying PowerSchool and then we're paying two different curriculum services, we're paying for a separate Instant Alert service, we're able to bring this all under one roof, under Infinite Campus. It's also then hosted, it's a web-based hosting through Infinite Campus, and that's got pluses and minuses, but the very big plus on that is if we have a service outage, we do not lose connectivity necessarily to our data through Infinite Campus. And Infinite Campus is run out of Minnesota. It's was built by people in the education world. And it's actually the company that was originally going to receive a state contract for student services. That state contract ended up not happening at all. But in looking at their interfaces and looking at how its functionality is, very user-friendly for our staff, our teachers, it provides us really with a robust parent portal. It provides us with robust teacher services. Teachers can do their curriculum planning in Infinite Campus. They can then translate that into, there's actually classroom web-based things. So we use Google Classroom. We could continue to use that, and that Infinite Campus is working on some functionality there, but it actually hosts their own types of systems where our teachers can get things out to students through Infinite Campus. The grade books are all there.
Do they have some demos or anything that any of the teachers have?
We brought in a group a year ago to look through that, and they looked through it at that time. At that time, we weren't really ready to move that direction. Some of the pieces with PowerSchool can be very clunky in terms of generating reports. It's not intuitive, whereas Infinite Campus report generating is very intuitive. We can, for instance, we have an attendance letter that we send out if a student's at risk of being truant. Right now, we have to do that on Word. We go into PowerSchool, we have to do hand calculate everything, because
brings everything to one.
Versus box. Now we can put this letter in right directly into Infinite Campus. We can even have our logo inserted onto this and make it look letterheadish. It will pull the data, insert it right into the letter that you need it. And what's interesting is at the end of the day, our office person hits a button that says, run truancy warning letters. It literally runs them and spits them out.
I mean, what is the age of that server right now that's in the house that's...
Well, it's probably not, it's not so much the age of the server, because we do get updates on PowerSchool, so that's not really, it's not really the hardware issue, it's the software side that we want to improve. Where we look to save on the server, ultimately, it's one less server we have to replace down the road.
Well, that's what I...
Yeah,
that's
so... Yeah, and one that now we can take it offline of PowerSchool at some point and then rededicate it to other district uses, increase some of our server capacity in other areas. So
if you're not paying these separate entities,
and we're not paying by moving this direction, we're looking to ultimately go down to one for the for a little less on a yearly basis for, once you add everything together, it's actually less on a yearly basis.
Not including potential.
Yeah, it's going to take us a year or two to transition all of this, but we're making the first transition in this summer. The other thing it's going to force us to do, and it's probably time we're forced to do this, it's going to force us to clean our data. So things like one person, when they entered Mr. Dobbin's children into the system, put Fourth Street, and they spelled out the word fourth, and then they spelled out the word street. And I know Ms. Lentz knows where I'm headed here. The next person put in fourth, and they put the number four, TH, and then spelled out street. But then the next person put fourth, and then they put street as an abbreviation. There's some issues that happen within the computer system that having, within a family even, multiple ways that somebody entered the data over time. So it's going to force us to consolidate that data. The other thing that's really kind of interesting is if I pull up Mr. Dobbin's, if I pull up his daughter, she'll come up, and then there's a tab over that says siblings. Now, all I need to do to know if there's siblings in the system is click the siblings tab. Right now, it's not that intuitive. You don't know that there's necessarily siblings just by looking at it. So there's all kinds of interesting pieces that will, again, it's just more robust, more powerful. Once we can migrate everything into it, eliminate some of the other programs, on a cost basis, it will be less over the long run. So
for a while, you'll be using both?
We're going to, because like they basically have said, you need to take this,
you can't just.
Don't just roll everything over. We're going to be able to roll over our special education program into this. It has its own special education program. We'll be able to roll that over into it. So everything can be housed under one roof, because right now special education is housed, again, in a completely separate program. And again, no connectivity between anything. So this allows those programs to be connected.
Sounds.
Yep. One last piece on that, and I'm all done, I promise, on my end. It was very interesting in the presentations and things we looked at. They actually have equate it to like a military command center. They literally have a map of the United States that has the red dots for all of their schools in their main computing center. All their schools are listed. That map tells them what the weather is in the location at those places. It tells them if there's like a tornado warning. So like if Port Edwards was under a tornado warning, their text back at their headquarters will then go into some protocols in terms of making sure that they've run timely, because they're constantly updating, but then they go in and make sure it's really been updated and it's timely, so that, let's say we had the critical event where the school went completely offline and we're looking at rebuilding our system, they have it and they're ready for us. So, and I cannot guarantee that right now. If we know we have PowerSchool backups going on, but not to the level of attention. So that's it for my report today. I know it's been kind of lengthy, a lot to get done. So,
all right, thank you. Item B, Principal Christie's report.
The first thing, on Monday, a small group of us spent the entire day at the ELC, and we started talking about scheduling. Now that we know that the fifth graders will be at the middle school next year, we went through some scenarios and some options, which we'll present to you next month at the board meeting, for how that will look and how the classrooms and schedule may possibly look. Now, granted, that depends on staffing. Our staffing can kind of drive how that schedule will look, as well as the decision as to class sizes, the number of sections, and at what point we want to split from one to two sections of the class. At what point do we decide that we need two sixth grades or two seventh grades, so on and so forth. So we'll be presenting that next week. We spent the entire day just on the middle school. However, once we know where we're at with one of those options, then we plan on getting together again in March and putting the rest of the pieces together. It's like a puzzle. It's like a domino effect, and we're not exactly sure how it's going to look, but at least that gave us a framework to start with and a couple options to present to you so that you can see where we're at with that. The other thing is our 4K, 5K registration. That is on February 20th at 5 p.m. at the elementary school. Please encourage anyone you know who has a incoming 4-year-old or 5-year-old to attend. It is an excellent presentation by our 4K teacher, Kayla Dorhorst from the YMCA, as well as our two kindergarten teachers. They will be talking about what to expect in kindergarten, how to sign up. They'll even have all the forms ready to go so that parents can sign their children up for next year. So if you know any little kinderbees ready to come, send them our way. So.
What's the date on
that? February 20th, 5 p.m. And there's also, we also provide childcare so that Ms. Sorbo comes and does a little art project with the kids in the art room, so that way the parents can listen and don't have to chase kiddos around. So. The last thing was the fifth grade transition to two teachers. It's been going very well. I haven't heard any complaints. Mrs. Waltenberg has fit right in, jumped right in. She and Mr. Martin have been collaborating. You know, it's been very good. The change in schedule with the FIED classes has worked out well. It's been perfect. I can't say anything negative about it. The kids have been great. You know, no one complained about whose homeroom they were in because they're still working together and collaborating. So it's been great, and it's been so nice to have two teachers with all those kids. So that's it.
Very good. Next item is the annual audit report. Shank SC.
Hello. Does anybody have the two annual financial report and management communication letter in the packet?
Great.
Well, again, my name's John Troutman. Been a few years since I've been presenting in front of you, but glad to be back. What I want to do tonight is really talk about last summer. So June 30th, 2016. You issued your audit report, your financial statements. Finally got those issued about 3-4 weeks ago. I'll spend a little bit of time explaining why there's such a huge delay. Certainly not your fault and certainly not our fault, but I'll go into a little bit more detail there. Really what I want to do is talk primarily in the management communication letter. So that's the smaller document. If you have a paper copy, it's a stapled document. That is designed for this meeting. It's designed for a very kind of a short, concise discussion on how your audit went. Everything in this document is really just repeated right from the annual financial report. The annual financial report is the full set of financial statements, the footnotes, and that's where our opinion is that we issue as part of your audit, obviously. So if you want to turn to page 1-4 of that communication letter, it goes through a lot of language as far as our responsibilities, our timing, our scope. None of that really changes from year to year. I encourage you to read it every year as a board, of course, because it contains valuable information. But honestly, it doesn't change a whole lot. There's a few words, a few changes from the standards coming through there. But the bulk of the information is on page 2. And that really goes through our consideration of your internal control. And again, we issue an opinion on your financial statements. So we come in here and we check your balances and make sure your financial statements as presented are materially correct. But internal control, we do not issue an opinion. No audit does. However, we do have to report matters that we see to you. And all four matters are exactly the same as other years. They're related to the size of the district. If I lined up all the districts in the state, almost all of them would have these, except for the very, very large ones that have, you know, 4 or 5 people in their accounting department. Well, small schools can't do that, obviously. So what that means from the board perspective, or you know, why is that important question, is really the first two, segregation of duties, relate to the fact that you just don't have the people to segregate all of the accounting internal controls. Much like any other business, you have one person, two people doing quite a bit. Well, that's a risk, obviously, because that one person is handling multiple sides of the transaction. Municipal government, same thing. A lot of small entities, same thing. What you need to know there is simply there's mitigating controls that you put in place as a board and as a district. And some of the things you do in this meeting and finance meetings or any other meetings where you review checks and you review payrolls and you look at different things, as a board, that's part of that mitigating control. You're actually getting involved in some of the day-to-day as far as monthly disbursements and so forth, and you're approving those. So someone else besides the accounting and the fiscal department are looking at that. Yeah, that's just an example, but those are the kind of things you're doing. Grant management, we couple years ago, we split that out simply because we wanted to point out really the side of the segregation with the grants. And they're really the same. You could really kind of combine those and say that's the same issue. We did that intentionally because our hope is even small districts will get to the point where they can eliminate that one. You're probably never going to eliminate the entire segregation of duties. No small districts can really do that in the budget times we live in as far as having limited resources to hire new people. But the grant management, so a lot of small districts are really starting to think outside the box when it comes to grants, because the federal government's starting to really crack down on some of the rules. And it really hasn't hit small districts yet, but the larger districts are very, very keyed in on this, because what they're trying to do is they're saying, okay, your Title I grant, explain to me the segregation process of that grant. Now, a lot of districts have, you know, it goes through the fiscal office much like everything else, so you have an issue there. That's why you're reading that. But a lot of smaller districts are saying, listen, we might not be able to do the accounts payable and the payroll and split everything out, but we're going to do the grants, and we're going to think outside the box and get more people involved. And you're in the process of kind of looking at that. You're not quite there yet like a lot of other districts, but that's why we split that out, just so you have an opportunity to eliminate one of those and work on one of those. The other two there, the 2015 two and four, are really related to the actual annual financial report. Technically speaking, if you open up that other bound document, every page in there except for the first two or three is designed and should be completed by the district staff. Well, that just doesn't happen. You don't have the expertise to put 25 pages of footnotes in there. Only the largest districts in Wisconsin do that. And even those districts, even some of the larger Division I districts, are not doing that. It's more cost effective to have the auditor do that. Once you have the auditor do that, which is okay, however, there is a risk there, obviously. We're preparing some of those financial statements, and the risk is you still, as a district, have to take responsibility for those in order for us to audit those. So that's kind of what this meeting is all about, really, to get me up in front of you or get one of our representatives up in front of you. And if you happen to look through it, you have some time to look through it, or even 2 months from now, you look through that and you're like, page 15, what is that all about? You just give me a call. Contact Lisa, she'll give me a call. I'll come back in if I need to explain it. So that education process is part of that, part of the audit process. Any questions on that? I know it's the same every year, but I like to spend a little bit of time on that just to make sure everybody's on the same page. Rest of page two, page three really goes through kind of a bullet point list of really any kind of issues we would have had in the audit. I'm happy to report we did not have any, but I always like to remind, it's a quick two-page read, 30-second read, just to see how things went. And we certainly appreciate all the assistance we get from Lisa and everyone else in the district in preparing this audit. So with that, it would be without that, it would be very, very difficult to do. Turn to page five. That's where we want to spend a few minutes here talking about the financial information. And you can see in the first bullet there, the first underscore, district governmental fund balances. What this does is it pulls in where you ended the year June 30th, 2016. General fund unassigned, your entire fund balance is unassigned, $1,893,000, down from $1,989,000 a year ago on June 30th, 15. So you can see, fairly consistent there, but dropping a little bit. You look to that graph down below, in the middle of the page, you kind of see a five-year comparison of that number. And you can see that a couple years ago, you had some committed fund balance for various projects, those commitments were released. And now you just have unassigned. So you can see kind of a roller coaster, not uncommon for smaller districts. Obviously, fluctuates based on what you do in that particular year. If you the rest of that page there, page five, is kind of a discussion, and it carries over into page six of really the fund balance level. So that $1,893,000 that you carried into the fiscal year you're in right now, is that a lot? Is that not very much at all? Should it be 10 million? Should it be at 500,000? Well, really what that page is devoted to is kind of explaining what the typical range or the typical minimum fund balance would be for school districts. And again, that's a general term. It's not a steadfast rule. There's some districts that operate much less than 20%. There's some districts that have more. So 20 to 25% is kind of an arbitrary range for a minimum fund balance, and that equates to $1.1 million and $1 to $1.4 million of fund balance, 20 to 25% is at of your expenditures. What that really means is about 3 months of expenditures, 4 months of expenditures, that you could operate and spend money, your normal operations, without any money coming in. Of course, you'd use all of your fund balance, so it's not something you want to do, but it puts it into a percentage instead of a dollar amount. So you can see you're above that. So you're at about 32%. You look at that graph there on page 6, it shows a 5-year comparison of that, and you can see it tracks the same trend as the previous page. But you can see you're over 30%, so definitely above the minimum, so that's great. I mean, you have the adequate reserves and the fund balances carried over into the next year. What that means is, because there's timing issues with school districts, all school districts, you receive funding at various times of the year. Property taxes don't get levied and don't get settled finally until August. So you operate almost the entire year without that. Grants come in quite a few months afterwards. Again, cash flow is a huge issue for school districts. A lot of districts have to short-term borrow because of that. Even if they have high fund balances, certain times of the year it dips too low. Again, having an adequate fund balance minimizes that need to do that. So that's good. Turn back to page 5 real quick. The special revenue funds on the top there, if you drop below the general fund, you have $44,000 in restricted for donations, and then a small $39 assigned for community service. So $44,000 in special revenue funds. Those funds are separate from the general fund, and they meet the requirements to be separate from the general fund, and they're earmarked for particular things. That's why they're in special revenue funds. $1,937,000 total district fund balances, governmental fund balances. So again, tracking slightly down in total as well, but very consistent with previous years. Any questions on that fund balance? Again, a good job in keeping that adequate fund balance. A lot of small districts can't do that, so you're in excellent shape. Page 7 really concludes this management communication letter by letting you know of a new accounting standard coming down. And again, this will be effective, it's GASB 74 and 75. There's a 2-year effective period. 74 is coming up this summer, June 30th, 2017. You are not applicable to 74. 75, which has the exact same requirements as 74, kicks in for all the other districts, and you're in that boat, so that would be 2018. So June 30th, 2018. What, obviously a lot of words here, and I'll let you read through that. The very, very short, what do I need to know here is, what this does, if you remember a couple years ago, we talked about Wisconsin Retirement System pension asset or liability coming on your books. This is simply, it's nothing to do with pension, but it's coming and now bringing in the OPEB. OPEB's been on your books for years, many, many years. But only a portion of your OPEB gets recorded as a liability. And that's called the annual required contribution, the ARC. Your actuary that you hire every couple years calculates that for us. So if your total liability is $2 million, your ARC might be $200,000. That's the only number that comes on your books. Well, GASB's changing that. GASB's saying, nope, we're not going to have just a portion of that OPEB on here. The entire OPEB is coming on, much like the entire pension asset or liability is coming on the books. That is why they're moving towards really transparency in your financial statements, whereas that information was all there for the last 5-6 years. It's just in page 35 in a footnote. No one looked at it, no one could understand that. Now they're putting it in the financial statement. Not sure if anyone still will understand it, but that's their hope, is that they'll see it on there and show it. Not a drastic issue, it's simply a change in reporting rules, and will change your front financial statements, the government-wide. Will it change what you report to DPI in your annual report? Not a bit. DPI doesn't care about any of that. That's your government-wide, so it's basically only for that report. So again, when we get to that point a couple years from now, I'll explain a little bit more. That brings me though back to, I guess, where I'll conclude, and that is what delayed this audit process and issuing the audit report. And that is related to an issue last year, last summer, when I don't know if Amber and Ryan, I think both of them might have been here presenting. That was the first year you had the Wisconsin Retirement System, your share of your pension asset in that case was on your books. Again, same financial statements that this liability is going to go on, your government wide. But last year we had to wait for the state audit report. The Legislative Audit Bureau issues a state audit report. And in that, There's a section on Wisconsin retirement system. Basically, if you add up all of the individual employees' Wisconsin retirement system money and compare it to, at the state, what they have in investments, that's your, either your asset, you're overfunded, they have more investments than they have participants, or you're underfunded and you have a liability. And then they back that all to every single participant, not only district, but municipality, everybody else, state employees, and they give that entire allocation and they assign it. So Port Edward School District got their assignment from the actuary report. Well, last year it was an asset. It was a fairly large asset last year. It was shocking how large it was. And that is because, of course, markets fluctuate. And this is as of a day, June 30th, in a particular year. Well, this year, we got indication that it was gonna probably be a liability. And some districts that I presented last year, I said, we gotta be careful because it's probably gonna start going like this, and it could. And we weren't sure how much, ended up being quite a bit of a liability. So here we have this huge asset, way higher than we expected a year ago, and now we have a liability. What it means though in Wisconsin, and what you have to worry about and understand is, Wisconsin's got a handle on their pension. So they're able to fund it. Yes, it's gonna drop a little bit, and then what do? They raise rates, bring it right back up. Other states, which is why this GASB ended up being created a few years ago, was you have some states that are 30, 40, 50% funded, that's it. So you add up all the investments, you add up all the participants, there's nowhere near enough investments. If everyone retired today, there wouldn't be enough money. So that's a problem, obviously. And that liability is a true liability to those participants and their financial statements. So that's really what that's about. This year, kind of a messed up situation from, at least from our perspective, because we had to wait, and we had to wait last year too, but it was issued, I think, in end of August, early September. Whereas this year, it did not get issued until the second week in December. So that's when we first saw the data. Well, that's beyond your due date of your audit, which is December 1st to DPI. So DPI scrapped the due date, and they made it, I think, January 10th or something like that. Well, everything was fine. We started going through the numbers right before Christmas. And we ended up finding something that didn't look right. Just didn't look right, so we started investigating it. Two other major firms, accounting firms in Wisconsin, combined we do probably 75-80% of the school district audits in Wisconsin. Started looking at it, and we all kind of joined together and said, this isn't right. And we sent it back to the Legislative Audit Bureau and said, we don't know what's wrong, but there's something wrong here. And they agreed, there's an error in the data. So we waited all this time for the data, and now it's wrong. So now we have all of our audit reports sitting there, ready to go. They've been waiting there, ready to go for 2 months, but we can't hit the button because they could be all wrong, and I can't issue an opinion on something I know is wrong. So we waited and waited. And that led us to probably the 10th or something like that of January, where they basically said, yes, it's wrong, we're not changing it. It's too small. Well, they opine, again, the state Legislative Audit Bureau opines on the number as a total. So of course, an error of pretty good size won't be enough to change the state's financial statements. So they said, we're not changing it, but we're gonna reallocate all, because the error was having to do with the allocation, it's gonna change everybody's total. So every district and every participant in the whole state changed a little bit. Well, we had no idea what that was gonna mean for your district and the other districts we do, which is quite a few. Luckily, it was minimal, like a couple $1,000s when we're talking about millions of dollars. So we said, we're not changing it either. I mean, it's a very minimal change. It's an estimate anyway. And to go back and redo the whole financial statements for $2,000 or $3,000 when you're talking about a $5, $6 million number, not worth it. So those numbers will pick up next year. We were worried at that point that it was going to be a material error and we had to reissue the financial statements. So luckily, it wasn't. So hopefully next year, I mean, it's going to be every year like this. I hope they get something in place at the state where we can issue audit reports and I'm not here in February presenting the audit for last summer. So hopefully, but that's why there was a delay. And at the end of the day, your financial statements are pretty good. So any questions on the audit, any questions on the audit process, I'd be happy to take. Keeps it interesting, that's for sure.
I'd like to thank Lisa because she really
suffered through
spends weeks preparing. So for the audit.
Can I just admit that I'm already having anxiety thinking about this year, so. No, it's a lot.
And I would like, to thank our auditing firm too, because they are very helpful through the process.
We have a great staff.
Like I said, any questions? Obviously, any, this stuff's kind of hard to read through, but as you're looking through that, if you have any questions, any comments, certainly do not hesitate to inform us. That's what we're here for. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, that leads us to questions and comments from people in attendance. Is there anyone that wishes to speak? Tim?
Yes, I do. I had a meeting yesterday with Mr. Cronin on a logo item and the branding issue. And so I want to come forth and just show you a few items that we have. About 3-4 years ago, our health department gave every kid and staff member a water bottle with them. We have it on, if you look on the website, it's up on the left-hand corner of the website. Mr. Parks on the boys' basketball team just produced this with it on, using the PE for Port Edwards, obviously. Had it on past items also, whether it be volleyball or basketball. This comes to me, and my daughters enjoy wearing the Blackhawk logo on their school uniform. It's a sense of pride. We have it at the elementary building too. It's on their class assignment books. It's on their Friday folders. It's on their name tags. Kids take pride in it. Here was a back-to-back championship for the boys' basketball team. I also went outside. I talked to the Booster Athletic Booster Club. They have it as their logo too. And this happens to be the Port Edwards Education Foundation.
That's not the foundation logo.
Hmm?
The foundation logo is
no
small.
That's what they're using. The smaller one is their official logo. Yes. Branding. The last piece of item kind of goes along with Mr. Bruno and the skills. My youngest daughter, Taylor, seventh grader, she made this not here at school. It was at tech welding class she went to over at Mid-State for a day. And the instructor was able to lift the Blackhawk off her website and then put it on metal. She cut it out and welded it. Something I didn't do in sixth, seventh grade.
No.
I don't think I got to welding until my sophomore, junior year in high school. And even then, I was very nervous. So my point of being here tonight is, I understand there is another fraction out there that would like to change it, the logo. But I think we have a sense of pride in us already. And I found it back in the athletic trophy case back to 97 with Mr. Weingard and Mr. Martinson as football coaches. If the kids are proud of who they are, why do we want to change something? We have it on the school vehicles. You know, we have it on the district magnets we hand out. It's on the cafeteria wall. If you look at your, scroll through the website, you can see it behind the men's alumni picture there. Various championship trophies we have it. And so, to me, I support Mr. Cronin. Yeah, we do. If we don't have a policy, we need to make one.
Policy would prevent, yeah, what prevents someone from just going on a, you know, website?
Putting a bear up there.
No, you can go on any website and tell them what you want and then produce it.
Right.
But a policy would hopefully keep that in check, right?
Right.
Yeah. Some sort of procedure policy or something along those lines.
Because, well, there's different designs, different.
And there are, because I just had something made at the printing shop. Over by Dairy Queen, what's it called?
Creative.
Yeah. And she's like, oh, what do you want? And I'm like, she's got 20 different hooks. But, you know, and I don't see that we're trying to change it per se, but say, hey, this is it. And this is the one I see everywhere. This hawk is the one that I would have, if I if somebody said, you know, what is your branding, I would have thought that.
Definitely the most prevalent.
Yeah, and I don't think the plan is to like change it. I'm thinking it's to say, yep, this is it, kind of. Yeah. I mean, do you guys agree?
Something
right.
Right.
Sort of?
Right.
Policies put out there, and then if people have different opinions, then there's a discussion.
Yeah.
And, but, you know.
I agree completely.
But yeah, having a policy is definitely the, what we have.
Well, getting input from everyone before we create the policy, you know, would be the way to go. Okay.
Kind of like I was going to earlier about down the river with Dan being the second one. There was such a majority of people when we lived in Nacoosa that wanted the paper maker symbol and keep it. So they came up with the alternative with the N, whatever font style that is, and it was agreed upon that they could use either or in the district on their school sports teams, logos and such. And they have over there. And I know other districts have too.
Right. I mean, I don't think it has to be absolutely just that one thing. I mean, maybe we're going to have two things that are acceptable.
Of course. Yeah. I mean, it's something we got to just take a look at. You know,
right.
What's the branding
right.
going to be?
Yep.
So, like I said, it kind of boils down to you can see Coca-Cola and Coke.
Yeah.
And they're written completely separate, but they both represent the same thing, and you know it.
Yeah, it's kind of like this is the symbol, this is the font.
Yep.
You know,
right.
Where it's more uniform.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thanks for coming. Thanks,
Jim.
Have a nice evening.
Just briefly, just you weren't in here when Kara was. Do you have any comments on how the fifth grade additional teacher is going? And if you don't want to comment, you know,
since you're right here.
You missed it. I was talking about how great you were, Tim, and you walked out of the room.
I'm sorry. I was late for a confirmation class. I had to get to a big work for a retreat. So that's why I asked the gentleman from the county, from how long are you going to be? He said 15, 20 minutes. I'm perfect. Left. I think it's going well. The kids have adjusted. It's not like they don't see me every day. I still have them. We're switching science and social studies within the fifth grade. For me personally, well, we went through two out of three already in school testing, so we got one left. So come May, it's going to be a lot less stressful for me. I don't have to test all 36, 37 kids. There'll be two of us. We can break it down 19-19. Jody's working out great as a partner. She slid right in and gave her a couple days. I said, here's how things go. And she's asking questions, taking notes. And now we're running our separate classes. You know, they're running separate, we've got the same curriculum though. It's going over the same information so the kids don't hear two different things. So it's going, it's very nice. Thank you.
Great.
Thank you, Jim.
Next on the agenda is number 6. Consider approval of minutes of past meeting. December 30th, 2016. This November 30th, 2016, December 21st, 2016, and January 11th, 2017. Is there a motion?
I so move.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed? Motion carried. Consider approval of financial reports. Number 7. Is there any gifts?
There were no gifts.
No gifts. Seek a motion to approve financial reports.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
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 So Nancy, auditor, mentioned that's your, when you receive those reports and can go through and look item by item, that's your check on that.
Yep.
The other piece you mentioned on the grants along with the financials, we are in the process of using CISA to help us administer the grants from the federal government. So that will hopefully be our help on that item that you kind of talked about. So.
And all those opposed? Motion carried on financial reports. Unfinished business. Consider final approval of class size limit policy.
And as I had talked last month, this policy really kind of goes hand in hand with the open enrollment piece. In order to be able to do the open enrollment piece, we have to have some policy in place regarding class size. And that's essentially what these numbers represent. Remember, the numbers are ranges, they're not absolutes. We could go either direction. In fact, I mean, it just says it's, you know, this is what will guide us. It might not be the, you know, it could very well be we've got 31 eighth graders in one section, just how it happens. Or, you know, so, but it gives us some guide and maybe that trigger point where it gets us looking at, do we need more or not? So.
Right. Is there a motion to approve class size limit policy?
I so move.
I second it.
A motion and a second. Any more discussion?
I have one question that was brought to me. It was kind of about the open enrollment limitations.
Yep.
It was from a mother who has one student that is already open enrolled here.
Yes.
And now they will be bringing another one in from another school.
Yes.
Will they have precedence over others?
Yeah, the way our policy reads, they do have preference.
Okay.
So.
That's what I thought. Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion carried. New business. Consider approval of pupil non-discrimination self-evaluation report.
Every 5 years, we're required by law to go through all of our data in terms of activities and scholarship awards. And even though we don't necessarily grant the scholarships, we still have to report all of this in our non-discrimination report. The district over the last, since this report's been required, the district has employed Fred Skiba. He's an educational consultant from Northern Wisconsin, and one of his expertise areas is developing this report because it is a once every 5 years, and it is pulling in data from multiple sources and places that we have here in the district. But again, because it's only done once every 5 years, if we've, and to be honest, we've overturned our offices, you'd have nobody that would even begin to know how to compile this by law. This is a legal requirement on us. In fact, even starting this report, we had to post that we were doing this process and doing the self-evaluation. And we'll have to, once the board, you basically would approve or accept the report tonight, you go, yep, we'll accept this report. We actually have to post again that the board has accepted it and it's now available for review. We have to have this to the state by the end of this spring. So it's quite a few legal processes that go on with this. It's a little more extensive in some ways in terms of preparing this particular report. It required a day where a group of key personnel in the district had to be available for interviews by Mr. Skiba. So we were, I was interviewed, Kara was interviewed, Jen Darnell, our high school counselor, Ronnie Bruink, middle and elementary counseling, Lori Gansprian, who does our special education, we were all interviewed as well. We had to post this as well because if public wanted to make comment, they were able to do so. I am going to, you can certainly look through the report, I'm going to skip to page number 17. These are the recommendations. There were three of them. The first recommendation, when printed materials are developed, be sure to include the pupil non-discrimination statement and the complaint procedure if needed. We do try to make an effort to do that on all of our official publications. So that statement is always out there. It's on our website. It's on our newsletter. So if we're officially publishing something, we try to include that statement. A recommendation to monitor student participation in athletics and activities on an annual basis and segregate the data by male, female, minority, and special education. Review data over at least a 3-year period. Watch for trends that may develop and take corrective action if necessary. Again, this I think is more suggestive in nature in the sense of telling us, try to just be cognizant The other thing this would allow us to do is, once the five-year period comes that we have to do this report, all the data's right there and ready to go. And we're not spending a lot of time trying to pull it and compile it and do that. And actually, in counseling, they've already done that with scholarships. So every year, that's being added, so we're able to go back and can monitor that. The thing that confuses me on this, again, we have to report this on scholarships, yet we don't control the outcome of the scholarship. So we have to report how many minority students received and whatnot. What we do have some control over is making sure we're pointing kids in the right direction, but we're not the ones giving the money. So, but you know, it will help us maybe point kids in some direction. And that is really the last one to watch for the trends on the scholarship piece. So those were the three major findings on this, really suggestions to us on to make sure that we're just monitoring this data and looking at it. You know, we at the moment have 100 students in the high school. It's sometimes hard to make a trend out of 100 students. You know, but we do certainly, we know our participation numbers right now aren't very high, but again, we have 100 students. So, but it also might tell us, you know, maybe we need to make sure that we're being inclusive of students in our special education population more so. So, you know, some things for us to look at and ponder. So that's the essence of the non-discrimination report.
Right. Seek approval of that report.
So moved. Second.
A motion and a second. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion carried. Next item, review of policy number 150, school board powers and duties, and first reading and proposed changes.
So the attachment, I did a strikeout in the attachment so you could see what the original language was, you could see what the new language. I thought this one would be a timely review because, again, with three of our board members being new within the last year, this is the policy that spells this out. I do want to, at some point, when you might be looking for a policy or something, and I'm going to back up before I really talk this policy, we did just recently re-index our policies on our website. Prior to about a month ago, our policies were listed by name. So you would have looked for this under the title School Board Powers and Duties. But you would have had to have known that's what we named it. And there is no single naming like procedure. So, you know, some schools might say student open enrollment, others might say pupil open enrollment, others might just say open enrollment. So we had on our website, all the policies were listed alphabetically. What we have done, WASB and most entities across the state use an indexing number system. All of our policies have always been numbered. So if you go on our website now, they're now in number order. And I'm gonna tell you, 100s deal with the school board, 200s deal with the administration, 300s deal with students, so they are all purposely indexed that way. So they're now by number order. Just if you happen to go on there and look, or if you had looked before and you now you're going, what did they do? They're now by number order with the number listed. So if you want to see what policy 150 is, you can go on our website and look at 150. So I did ask the WASB for some samples here. I could toss 30 samples at you on this one in particular. They're almost all worded completely different. So I just went with what we do have to change in this one at the moment and looked at this. This is certainly, these are the powers and duties of the school board. Different schools word it differently. They if they have different management philosophies, it's completely worded differently. On number 9, as you see, it says to oversee the process of negotiations, and it used to say whereby personnel salaries, fringe benefits, and working conditions are determined The state did away with that. The only negotiated item is base wage. Rather than stick the words in, negotiate base wage, we used a catch-all. We put where allowed by law. So we're basically saying is whatever the law allows you to negotiate, that's what you can negotiate. If the law doesn't allow you to negotiate, you can't negotiate it. That just cleans it up in case the law ever changes again. It may very well change at some point. So that was the suggested change there. It's just to put that language in there so that it doesn't give you the power to negotiate things you don't really have the power to negotiate by law. So beyond that, I didn't suggest any other changes. If there were wording changes you'd want to make, if there were other things. And again, as we go through a review of policy, I thought, again, this one might be a good one for you to take a look at. So, and it's on here as a first reading because we did not make an editorial change to this. You know, we didn't change an S somewhere. You're changing the meaning of one, so that's why I put it as a first reading. So there's no action that you actually have to take.
Come back and revisit that next month and bring any changes you want.
If we want more, and just because we typically do a first and second reading, if it doesn't quite right to where you want it, we can go back to it. We don't have to approve it on a second reading either. So.
All right, on to number 11, discussion of future policy review and adoption.
Okay, so I put this item on. Because I'm going to tell you, we have 116 policies, most of which have not been reviewed since 2002-2003. There are probably a few policies that we do not have that we need to have. I was able to find some documents on the WSB website that allowed me to kind of at least do a snapshot of our own policies. The reason I put this on for discussion is if we go about this policy by policy, it's gonna take 116 meetings to review all the policies. There's some we may not have to review right at the moment. We just, and I know the board is relatively new, but only a year ago we changed our open enrollment policy. That one's really not due for, we don't have to review that one right away. There are some that we're going to need to be dealing with because the laws have changed. Some that, again, we probably should have that we don't. The policy review is, as you may begin to see, will become tedious. The other piece of this is, in order for me to go back and look at these and bring suggestions to you, I'm able to go to WSB and say, hey, what are some sample policies? And that's exactly, they'll send me a dozen sample policies of other districts. And again, they all could be worded. WSB will not give me any other advice because we do not subscribe to that service. They have a specific service we could subscribe to where they would say, where they would actually come in and look at all of our policies and go, these need to be changed right now. You need to update these today or in the next month or two. And this is how we would suggest you do that. And again, they guide and say, here's where you probably have some room that the board could say, this is how we want to deal with this. And there's other places where state law dictates it. Along with that, the WSB also has a policy service that would be more guiding for me, where I would have then some more access to their legal consultants and more access to maybe some more direct language, like they would say, use this language, rather than just giving me a dozen samples and saying, yep, there you go, figure out what you want to do. Those are costly. They're not cheap, but maybe it's something in order to get a handle on policy. And again, I put this on here for discussion and no decision needs to be made. Let me pull up.
When you say they're costly.
Well, there's a charge to it. They can audit our policies for They can audit our policies and do a complete review of our policies and tell us what we're missing, what we need to change, what's not up to date by law that we haven't updated over the years. They could do that for one of two fees. It's either $3,000 or $1,500. And I think if you remember back in December, John Ashley talked about that, their policy review. The reason it's either $3,000 or $1,500, it's $3,000 if that's all you want them to do. They'll come through an audit and tell you what you need to change. They may not tell you exactly how you need to change it, but they'll say, you know what, in policy 150, item number 9, you have a problem there. You need to change it. But they may not tell you, do this to policy. They're just going to tell you, here's where you have problems, other problems, or where you're missing policies.
Kind of like when you say check for errors, and it tells you this is an error.
Yep, kind of, that's what their service will do. I have a document here I wanted to pull up and make sure. I know where I put it. Excuse me for just a moment. I had a lot of files I was bringing with me today. So that's called their quick check service. Upon request and after the WSB is provided with a print copy of the district's policy manual, a consultant will do a quick check identifying the following. They'll identify any policies that seem to be missing from the policy manual. This includes policies and procedures mandated by state and federal law, and any other recommended policies. And they'll then look at also local policies with last revision date indicating that they may need updating due to recent law changes. So they're doing that check for error, as you said. Again, it's $1,500 or $3,000. The reason it's either $1,500 or $3,000, if then you want to take it, it's $3,000 if that's all you want them to do. If you want to take it to the next level, and then they're going to give us their policy resource guide, which gives us all of their legal services, their policy help, the background information, the guiding documents, the whole kit and caboodle. That's a 3-year subscription. It is a 3-year subscription runs $3,950 a year. You have to buy a 3-year subscription. $3,950 a year. The $1,500 is just for the, that is, that $1,500 would be the reduced rate on the quick check if you buy the guide. So they'll reduce your quick check rate if you buy the guide. The guide is a 3-year subscription. The quick check without the guide is $3,000. And the only reason I'm bringing this up is I want us to make sure that we are at least compliant with the law. I've been at this a year and a little longer, and it was evident to me just after doing a very quick review on my own, there's a few places we've got holes and we need to fill those. But I am beholden to looking at documents that they're able to provide and say, you should have this policy, but now I've got to go back and find, are there samples of the policy anywhere? Is there state guidance, federal guidance? That's a very time consuming. And when you're looking at 116 policies that currently exist, and I'm going to suggest we will, by the end of whatever process we pick, we're going to have more than 116. We might not have 150, but we're going to definitely have more than 116. You know, it's just something for discussion, something to put in your mind. I don't know that we need the Cadillac, but on the other hand, it might behoove us to make sure that we're compliant to at least, maybe at least look at the idea of the quick check.
I think given the amount of time it's been
right
since some of these have been reviewed.
Yeah, it's been since 2002. That's a long
might be, it
time.
It wouldn't be a bad idea.
School notifications, they always come in fours.
Yeah.
You're getting a school notification.
School games.
Oh.
Yeah. So I put it on there for discussion. We could propose, I wanted to give you some thought and time to think about it as well. I also wanted to just toss out those numbers.
One thing I could ask WSMA, I have not asked them this yet. I could ask them, okay, would you do the quick check? And if we're really in need of, if you find a bunch of things, can we come back to you and get the reduced rate on the quick check if we buy the guide then?
Yeah.
We'll pay the full rate if we have to, but we may, you know, I'm going to ask them and see, you know, because it may be after the quick check, we might look at it and go, yeah, we really want the policy guide.
No commentary from them on a quick check? I mean, there's got to be some.
It does not include a substantive review and analysis of policy content, a more substantive review and policy, particular policies and specific assistance in preparing policy updates is available through the WAC Policy Consulting Service. And they'll do that on an hourly fee. Or you can at least get their guide, which is all of the, at least the, it's all their background. They might not give you the hourly, with the guide, they won't give you the hourly, you know, so there's some different fees in there and things we could do, you know, but at least the quick check would point out the glaring errors, or omissions, or things we need to just get done. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I want to get it done, I would think you will want to get this done.
Yeah.
But it is going to be a process no matter which route we go. That's why I said, banging this out one policy a month probably isn't going to get us there.
No, but once we go through this process,
yep.
Then it could yep. just be ongoing.
And I have heard of boards, what they have done is every couple of months held a policy meeting where all we do is we're going to get together and we're going to go, okay, here's a bunch of policies, let's look at them. It may be to do.
Because I can't see how you can get everything done
yes.
without.
Right.
Yes,
without
they'll do. They would do. They would basically say, okay, we're going to have a. We're basically going to have a policy committee meeting, and we're going to hammer out policy. Right. Yeah, any way we do this, it really came to a realization as I started. Once we got the policies in number order, finally. And then I started opening them up and I went, oh boy, I think the first 10 I opened up, I went 15 years, 14 years, 13 years. Yeah. So, and we've been reactive. We've tried to be reactive where we know we've had to be, but I know probably stuff has passed us by.
Well, I mean, you want to obviously be
proactive.
Right. And head off any legal potential repercussions.
Yeah. The reactive piece is the state passes a new law and we react to it and change the policy.
Right.
Yeah. You know, so.
Yeah, we definitely need to think about this.
Yeah.
Let me do some consulting further with WSB and some more discussion with them on how we can do this. They used to charge a flat fee one time of $7,500 for their policy resource guide. The reason they went to a 3-year subscription they actually wanted to spread it out for districts because $7,500 was that, you know, people were kind of choking at that. I still kind of go $4,000 for a year, for 3 years. But on the other hand, again, being a small district, being pulled a bunch of ways in all of our people, it's, you know, we do our best to stay on top of it, but so. Any other questions? Again, no decision on that, just discussion. So, okay.
Next item, consider approval for post-employment benefits. Carol Board.
Well, these are always bittersweet.
They are.
I'm certainly happy for Mrs. Board to make that decision in her life, and we will be very sad to see her depart the district as a teacher. So. And I would recommend the school board approve that.
I so move with sadness. Mixed emotions, I guess.
Yeah. Got a motion and a second. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion carried. And make sure you let her know on behalf of the board. Thanks for all of your many years of service.
Yeah, she's had a difficult year. She has a big class this year.
Okay. Consideration and approval of resolution supporting a change in the legal start date of school.
Mr. Thomasgard had asked that, and he is not able to be here tonight, but he'd asked that this be considered. So the WASB, as you saw in your notes, has a resolution. Unlike where we have to read through the proclamations, John does not have to read through this resolution line by line, so long as you all can see it. So basically, there is legislation right now out being written to change, to essentially eliminate the mandated September 1, can't start before September 1. This year, we're going to be starting football by August 1st. We've had a year or two where we've played three football games prior to the start of the school year. We played volleyball well prior to the start of the school year. Our kids who are involved in those things are certainly here. From a political standpoint at the state level, there's going to be two trains of thought on this, I perceive. One is local control, that give local entities control of the start date. The other side is Wisconsin is a tourism state. And just in speaking with fellow administrators from maybe a very touristy area south of us, that area is not in favor of this legislation. So Leo put this on here wanted to bring this to you. He thought it was, all this resolution would do is say, Port Edward School District would support this legislative effort. It doesn't commit you to anything else beyond that, if you so choose to do that.
I mean, I think school districts are, like you say, all different. And they should have the local control. And if we could start school earlier, it would make a difference with our summer school at the end, because that is a real problem. And I mean, remembering back when I was teaching, kids are ready to come back in August, but they're ready to be done in June. And the longer you go in June, the less effective they seem
and
to be.
And this mandated start date is not, I mean, 20 years ago, this hasn't always been here.
Right,
I was just
right.
Going to ask
no,
the question.
No,
is,
it wasn't.
Because
you're
trying to look it up. When was it mandated?
I
will
tell you. It was 2003 was the school year.
Yeah, 2003.
Because I remember that was the year we switched from having graduation. It was on Memorial Day, or Sunday of Memorial Day weekend, and that class of 2003 was the first year, it was the June.
So, I mean, I would assume that I can recall when schools generally start, have started.
And it's different everywhere. And we might not be looking to, this might not be something the board looks to radically change, but you might say, yeah, we want to get going by that last week in August, or...
Right, it might only be 3 or 4 days difference, and that will make a difference on the other end. Also.
Well, and for next year's
snow days, too,
for next year's calendar, it would make a difference. It really would. If we could switch up next year's calendar, we could. Because remember, we have a goofy date next year where we're in school on a Monday. It just we couldn't fit the days in that September.
I mean, we're pretty locked into next year's school calendar.
Yeah, at the moment. I mean, if we had to tweak it, we could. But
like if we in August, if school could start on August 28th, in-service could be that week before, and you'd have those 4 days.
We could have easily ended next year's calendar. Shortly after Memorial Day, or at that time frame, and avoided the idea of now or.
But we don't have to start after the first. Yeah. And the first is a Friday, so that's one day.
And that's why this next that calendar you approved, we didn't start on that Friday because that's already now going to be a long weekend for families.
Right.
And that Friday would be, we kind of viewed it as which one are we going to get more value out of?
Yeah.
So,
exactly.
And I don't know that you get value out of either one.
No.
So.
I mean, it would be very nice if local schools could set their own calendar.
I agree.
So if you take action to approve this, you'd approve this resolution, And we would, it's symbolic in nature. We, you could say that we will send it to, we could prepare it and send it to our local legislators and say the school district passes in support of this legislation. That's typically what we've done when that's happened.
So. I so move that we approve that resolution.
I second that.
Then a motion and a second. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the resolution, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carried. Opportunity for individual board member comment. Carrie.
I'd just like to comment again on the, a little bit what Mr. Bernal comment, or, you know, brought to us with the that skills program and just the need for a portion of our students to consider trade schools or trade work in their immediate future. They're going to be needed. So it's a lot of fun.
I have nothing.
Crazy. Huh?
I just want to say how much I appreciated being able to attend the school board convention. The three keynote speakers were absolutely wonderful. If I had only heard one of them, it would have been wonderful, but to hear all three, they were great. I attended seven breakout sectionals that were also really good, so that was a great experience for me, and I learned a lot. I also would like to encourage people to vote on February 21st. It's a very important election for our state school superintendent of public instruction, Tony Evers. He's a strong proponent of public schools, and we definitely need him at this time. So usually primary elections are low turnout, and we really need people to get out and vote for Tony Evers.
Yeah, I guess the only thing I have is I enjoyed the convention also, and I think the speakers were one of the best that I've seen there. I've been going to it like 5 years now, so. And there was a lot of good information in the breakout sessions that I went to as well. So that's it. Number 15, establish future board meetings. We have Wednesday, March 8th and Wednesday, April 12th as our next two board meetings. Do we want to make one for May? Or just me? May would be what?
10th.
May 10th, my birthday.
All right. Gosh, we have to have a cake. How many candles do we have to put on, Jen?
Too many.
29th?
May 10th. Yeah, we can do May 10th. Is that all right for them?
Yeah, that's a
Okay.
So we added May 10th to that?
Yeah.
Okay.
And next item is consider motion to adjourn into closed session. And would entertain a motion to do that.
I so move.
Second.
Your motion and second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? We are in closed session.